Hello, I'm Professor Von Schmohawk, and welcome to Why You. In the previous lectures, we saw that we can change a fraction's form without changing its value if we multiply its numerator and denominator by the same number. For example, the fraction 1/3 can be written as 2/6 if we multiply the top and bottom by 2. Or by multiplying the top and bottom by 2 again, it can be written as 4/12. Of course, doing so will create an equivalent fraction with a larger numerator and denominator. But it is also possible to do this process in reverse by dividing the numerator and denominator by the same number. This creates an equivalent fraction with a smaller numerator and denominator. So this is called reducing or simplifying the fraction. In order for a fraction to be reduced, it must have a numerator and denominator which can both be divided by the same number. In other words, they must both have a common divisor. But how do we know when this is the case? Sometimes it is obvious. If we look at the fraction 4/8, it is easy to recognize that the numerator and denominator are both divisible by 4. And so this fraction can be written as 1/2. And most people would recognize that the numerator and denominator of 20/30 are both divisible by 10. But then sometimes it's not so obvious. The surest way to determine whether or not a fraction can be reduced is to factor the numerator and denominator. For example, say we wish to determine if the fraction 15/21 can be reduced. Factoring the numerator and denominator, we can see that they both have a factor of 3 in common, so we can divide the top and bottom of this fraction by 3. Of course, this has the same effect as simply removing a factor of 3 from the top and bottom. In other words, we cancel out a factor of 3 in the numerator and denominator. This reduces the fraction to 5/7. As another example, let's simplify the fraction 30/42. Factoring the top and bottom, we see that they both have a factor of 2 and a factor of 3 in common. After canceling out the factors of 2 and 3, we are left with 5/7. Let's do a couple more examples. Let's reduce the fraction 30/72. We first factor the top and bottom. This time, the bottom has 3 factors of 2 and 2 factors of 3. However, since the top has only 1, 2 and 1, 3, we can only cancel out a single factor of 2 and a single factor of 3, which leaves us with 5/12. As our last example, let's reduce 7/63. The 7 in the top is a prime number, but we can factor the 63 in the bottom. When we cancel out the factors of 7 in the top and bottom, we will be left with a 9 in the bottom. But what about the top? Since 7 is the same as 7 times 1, when we cancel out the 7s, we are left with 1/9. We have seen that the process of reducing a fraction involves determining which factors the numerator and denominator have in common. In this example, the fraction has several common factors. These common factors include the prime numbers 2 and 3. But we could also name other factors common to both the numerator and denominator. For example, the composite numbers 4, 6, and 12. The product of all the common prime factors is the greatest common factor. In this example, the greatest common factor is 12. And once we eliminate the greatest common factor, the fraction is reduced to its simplest form, which in this example is 5/6. The fraction 5/6 is called a proper fraction since it represents a value less than 1. However, sometimes arithmetic operations result in fractions greater than 1, called improper fractions. In the next lecture, we will learn how to convert these improper fractions to a different form involving an integer plus a proper fraction.